Good afternoon. My name is Helen Bogusek, and I'm your cantor this afternoon. As we humbly gather in this sacred space on the 12th Sunday in ordinary time, we seek the God who rescues the poor and the downhearted. It seems to be a part of human nature to fear the unknown. As a child, it might have been the darkness. As an adult, it may be any unfamiliar event or task that is in our future. In today's gospel, Jesus addresses the 12 as a parent might console a child. He encourages his followers to put their trust in his word and in his friendship for them. He assures them that the Father's love is as tender as that for a sparrow and as deliberate as knowing the numbers of hairs on their head. Strange comparisons, but we are that precious in the sight of God. Our presiding homilist at this Eucharist is Father Kevin. Please stand. The parish family of St. Margaret of Cortona strives to be a welcoming community. In that spirit, we invite you to introduce yourself by name to those assembled around you.
Thank you. Christ your Son lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen. Reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah said, I hear the whispering of many, terror on every side. Denounce, let us denounce him. All those who are my friends are on the watch for any mistake of mine. Perhaps he will be trapped, then we can prevail and take our vengeance out on him. But the Lord is with me, like a mighty champion. My persecutors will stumble, they will not triumph. In their failure, they will be put to utter shame, to lasting, unforgettable confusion. O Lord of hosts, you who test the just, who crow mind and heart, let me witness the vengeance you take on me. For to you I have entrusted my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has rescued the life of the poor from the power of the wicked. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
sin, death. And thus death came to all men, inasmuch as all sinned. For up to the time of the law, sin was in the world. Though sin is not counted when there is no law. But death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those who did not sin. After the pattern of the trespass of Adam, who is the type of the one who was to come. But the gift is not like the transgression. For if by the transgression of the one, the many died, how much more did the grace of God and the gracious gift of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow for the many? The word of the Lord.
Sister Dorothy and I were traveling to a baseball game. And as we're in the car going to the game, all of a sudden, miraculously, we appeared in a baseball stadium. And players on the field, and next to me on my right was Jesus. Next to Sister, on my left and her left, was the devil. I had to get one more shot in here, you know. I had to get one more shot. So it was the bottom of the ninth, 0-0 score, and the Lord's team was up. So the first batter up was Love, and Love hit a cracked a single, because you see, Love never fails. And then the next batter up was Hope. And Hope likewise cracked a single. Because you see, Hope always follows Love. And then the third batter up was Godly Wisdom. And Godly Wisdom took Satan's pitches, ball one, ball two, ball three, ball four. Because you see, Godly Wisdom just doesn't swing at Satan's bad pitches. And finally, Satan lets out, the devil lets out a big sigh of relief, because the batter coming up seems to be nothing special at all, kind of small of stature. I think he's out of his trouble. His team's out of trouble. But you see, this last batter hit the ball harder than any baseball has ever been hit in the history of the sport. The center fielder goes back, goes up, but it was hit so hard it takes his glove off his hand, over the fence for a home run, the game ended. And Jesus goes to myself and sister, do you know why this happened? You know what the name of that last batter was? And why it happened this way? We both said no. You know, because the last batter was named Grace. Love, hope, godly wisdom will get you on base, but it'll take my grace to bring you home. My friends, in life we have, that is so true. We all are people who love, we all are people who have hope, and we all have a wisdom given to us by God. And all those things have brought us here today to first and foremost to worship our God, but also to honor this very special woman. Now, you might not believe this, but over the years that we've been together, on very rare occasion, I have had some fun at her expense. First of all, you find it's hard to believe that something, when I first came here, somebody had told me, before I really knew her, before I really met her, I was told that people are leaving the parish because of her. And that is obviously very much not true and very much a ridiculous statement. But there are times when maybe she made a little fumble in something she said, and I, being the kind, generous person that I am, I had some fun at that. Now, I promise her I will not repeat a couple of those things. But then your family can see me afterwards. Right. Okay. But over the years, we've had, I know, you guys will appreciate this. I don't know how many times we're in my office. She could come in and talk, you know, every day when we're both in the office, and she would say, I'm leaving. And then an hour later, she's still there, talking. And then one time, this is bad. I almost feel guilty about this. I almost feel guilty, especially today. One time, I was teasing her, just her and I in the office, and she goes, you'll miss me when I'm gone. And I said, prove it. But in the 10 and a half years that I've been here, and I have to tell you, I've been priest for 36 and a half years, and I'm looking back at those years and on the people, the staff that I work with in places. And first of all, I've never worked with anybody as long as Sister Dorothy. You know, we had women religious at my last pastor here, but none I was with that long. And I must say, anybody I've worked with in these, my last 36 and a half years, I've never been closer with anyone more than sisters. That includes priests. You know, I've never been a genuine friend. And two things that I think needs to be said about her, and those of you who work with her, particularly notice, but I can't tell you how many times that she spoke so glowingly about the children of this parish and religious education, and how good they are, and how willing they are to learn. And I must say, when I talk with them in class and stuff, you could tell that these students know their stuff. But she constantly has repeated how good that our children are. And secondly, she would say the same thing constantly about our catechism, about how special a group they are, unheralded as they are in many, many instances. And so I just meet you, I needed to say that publicly. One thing we talked, and I know it's sad that she's leaving, and how she's leaving us after so many years. But we talked a number of times about this before we knew this was happening. But one of the dangers that anybody who works for the church, particularly in a parish, is that we think that that we're irreplaceable. And we both agree that the only one that's irreplaceable in a parish is the Lord. Yeah, and that's important. That's she's always very rooted in that. We most certainly are going to miss her. I am going to miss her. Well, I choked up about it. I'll miss having not somebody to talk to in the office. I mean, Dean is here, of course, but she would still come in and counsel it. I will miss that. But you're a phone call away. You know, and I'm going to use that because, to still seek your guidance on particularly the area of religious education. One final thing I want to say. Sister's going to speak to us afterwards, okay? And I will give her the last word. I will not come back if she chooses to make up for those few times when I had some fun at her expense. But there's one line from the gospel today. Everyone who acknowledges me before others, I will acknowledge before my Heavenly Father. Sister, for 29 years has acknowledged, Jesus through her life, through her work, through her love for all of us. And even years before, I need to acknowledge, too, her order, because her order has been here since, Sister's been here with us since the 1990s. Her order's been here since 1970. Order that's kind of dear to me, you know this, but if you don't like me, blame her order. Because they educated me in Jersey City in grammar school, right? And then in a couple of my parishes, that I've been assigned to, they were there, Hillsdale, Oakland, and now of course here. So we acknowledge her order being such a and so we'll miss that too. But she and every single one of us, through God's grace, if we want to really honor her, and obviously we celebrate her, we'll say farewell, we'll talk to her today, we'll have a reception over in the hall for her, you greet her personally. But if we really want to honor her, then what she did for us, bringing Christ into our lives, into our midst, then we'll seek to do what she's done for us, we must now do for others. She's been a wonderful example. example of her order, of the Lord, serving the Lord. We are now called to do that as she prepares to move on. I laugh in retirement. She can retire for 10 years. One of the things, especially as pastor, shepherd, financial shepherd of this parish, she's been coming up here to us as a volunteer.
Wow.
You know, she's been coming up to us as a volunteer. So we're very grateful for that. So we honor her by honoring the Lord, by being willing to be ministers of the Lord in our lives, whatever that means.
Thank you.
So, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, with all the host of powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, the glory, and the glory of God
forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Son. We ask of your mercy, Lord, that what we celebrate in constant devotion may be our sure pledge of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
You all know how I feel about this
very much at home with people with whom I feel so comfortable. Thank you for that. There are so many people to whom I owe special thanks. The catechists, and thanks, Father, for mentioning them. Not just those who presently minister, but many who have helped me through the years. I see some of them here today. Oftentimes, when a parishioner's name comes up, I find myself saying, oh, he or she was a catechist many years ago. But I oftentimes am given credit for what they did and what they do. For all my time here and before my time, the needs of the families were met by these extraordinary, very generous women and men. For those families who are wondering what happens now, I assure you your kids are in good hands. The coordinators will make sure the program remains strong and effective. They are already part of the program, and they know how cooperative parents are and how wonderful your kids are. I have to thank also the Faith Formation Board, with whom I planned so many parish activities and with whom I had so much fun. I know many of the activities sponsored by the Faith Formation will be brought back to pre-pandemic days. The Advent Giving Tree, again what I got credit for, was possible through the care and hard work of many people and the generosity of this parish community. My years of Bible study brought me into contact with great people whose curiosity and love for God's Word expanded my own knowledge and love of Scripture. To you, I am grateful. Thank you, Eileen, and the choir members for the extra time you all put in to prepare for today. Weren't they great?
Yes.
I've never heard it sung so well. Anticipating the light reception after this liturgy, I am grateful to those who have helped with this, with very special thanks to Vito. Now there's Father Kevin. Payback time. You know, I always believed that part of my responsibility here was to make Father Kevin look good. So I ask you, how did I do? Seriously, he is a very good person and a wonderful priest and a dear friend. As most of you know, Father Art's sickness and death coincided with Sandy. It was a tumultuous time for all of us. I was grateful when Father Kevin arrived on the scene, and I continue to be grateful for his support and for his friendship. Now, in addition to marking the start of the Korean War today, and I thank anyone who has served in that conflict, today marks something else. Does anyone know? Well, I'm not crazy with this. Today is Global Beatles Day. Not the insects. I, like most of you, are not into pop culture. However, I know the Beatles. At least I know about the Beatles. Example. I don't know whether you knew Father Kevin was a big Beatles fan. You're going that way. History buff, Martin Giant fan. So everybody knows how close Bazzarelli's is. Right, we can practically walk it if we were in good shape, right? Well, oftentimes we would go out for a sandwich. Well, sometimes, mostly to Bazzarelli's. As soon as he picked me up in the car, I got in, and guess what music was on? The Beatles. And You know, I learned on those very short trips that John Lennon was raised by an Aunt Minnie. That Paul McCartney was reared by his dad, who was some jazz something or other, and who wrote Let It Be on the death of his mother. And I have learned many other trivia facts about the Beatles, which I will never use at the villa. Those of you that have been into the Paris Center know that we have this big clock, beauty, it really is beautiful clock. And when the hour strikes, we have Beatle music. Incidentally, it needs a battery. So, that's my story here today. I'm happy I got through it. But when I leave here in a few days, know that I take you with me, in my heart and in my prayer. I pray that God will give each of you with the same love and joy that you have showered upon me during my years here. I pray that St. Joseph will care for you and for St. Margaret's with the same love with which he cared for Jesus and Mary. Take good care of yourselves and your families. I will miss you. You know where I am if you need me. Thanks again.
Behind the minister myself, Sister